Random House Audio presents Warren Beatty, A Private Man by Suzanne Finstad. Read for you by Dylan Baker. The year he turned 38, the pathologically private Warren Beatty gave an interview in which he made what may be the most revealing statement he has ever given. Whatever you have read or heard about me through articles or gossip, forget it. I am nothing like that Warren Beatty. I am nothing like what you have read. Beatty was at the height of his mystique surrounding Shampoo, the sexual satire he co-wrote and produced, a film in which he played an aimless playboy presumed to be based on him. The true Warren Beatty has been the actor's closely guarded secret. The first clue is his real name, Henry Warren Beatty, honoring his great-grandfather, a Southern Baptist from a long line of Virginia Baptists dating to the Revolutionary War. Beatty described them once as a Southern family that went to enormous lengths to maintain privacy, a tradition Beatty has elevated to an art form. Over the years, when people expressed fascination that the same obscure Arlington couple produced Warren Beatty and Shirley MacLaine, arguably the most successful brother and sister in Hollywood history, two Oscar-winning movie stars with vividly disparate tabloid personas, Beatty as a supposed sexual satyr and recluse, his sister as the champion of psychic channeling, their father, Ira Beatty, would wink and say that he'd always done his best work in bed. As an old man in the last stages of illness, Warren Beatty's father became fixated on what even he considered the great mystery of his two children's talent and fame, concluding that it must be their Scotch-Irish genes somewhere way back there. Ironically, what Ira Beatty failed to see was that he and his wife, Kathleen MacLaine Beatty, known in the family as Tat, were the fount of Warren and Shirley's successes as well as the underlying source of their psychological intricacies. The hidden agenda here is my mother and dad, Shirley MacLaine, who was born Shirley MacLaine Beatty, said once, "Whatever creative interests Dad had were put aside, and Mother was desirous of being an actress all her life, read poetry, and was a great painter. They devoted their lives to us. I think both Warren and I have a need, a deeply felt melancholy respect for the dreams unrealized by our parents. So we fulfill theirs and ours." In the fall of 1928, Kathleen Tat MacLaine and Ira Beatty made their unlikely acquaintance at Maryland College for Women in the tiny town of Lutherville, Maryland. Tat was an instructor in drama and speech, then called elocution, from a refined Nova Scotia family. Ira, a professor of psychology and education with Virginia Baptist roots and an overbearing, at times violent mother. The two made distinctly different first impressions on campus, an early clue to their deeper discord. "She was extremely popular with all the students, and he wasn't," recalled Mabel Symington Moore, a belle who enrolled in 1929. "He was sort of a know-it-all." If so, it was false bravado, the same insecurity that led to Beatty's occasional use of alcohol, partly to mask his disappointment over abandoning his dream to be a concert violinist. By his second year, Warren Beatty's father had won over his female students. "All the girls were in love with him," declared Winifred Wokel Morrison, who took both psychology and education from Beatty. "He was a very good teacher, actually." Her impression of Ira Beatty was as a dyed-in-the-wool man of the South. Even though it was a small school, no one at the Maryland College for Women seemed to know when, during their 3 years as unmarried professors, the extremely proper Miss MacLaine and Mr. Beatty began their romance. In a letter, Kathleen MacLaine once described her future mate, pointedly, as teaching part-time, while taking his PhD at Johns Hopkins University. Tat was the daughter of a progressive physician and mayor, and clearly placed importance on Ira Beatty's receiving his doctorate. Ira Beatty later told their daughter Shirley that if he could not be a violinist, he wanted to contribute to the betterment of the human race and saw education as the way. Ira Beatty's romantic humanitarianism appealed to the poet in Kathleen MacLaine and would reproduce powerfully in the ideals of their son, Warren. During the summers, Tat performed with a local repertory company, and Ira participated, using the college gymnasium for their shows, the Beatty's vaudeville period, the couple referred to it later. After their third year teaching at Maryland College, Warren Beatty's parents were married on August 31, 1931, despite his mother's feelings of foreboding. In January, Ira Beatty's application for his doctorate was accepted, with the expectation he would take his oral examination in the spring and launch his married life with Tat as a doctor of philosophy. Instead, Beatty's thesis was rejected, and he was denied his PhD by Johns Hopkins. Ira blamed his female advisor, even though a different academic determined that he had insufficiently researched the topic. Beatty's already frail ego was permanently affected, and the PhD that eluded him became a symbol of the impotence that dominated the atmosphere in the house where Warren Beatty grew up. Act 1. The Good Son. Instead of beginning the summer of 1932 as Dr. and Mrs. Beatty, Ira and Tat left Lutherville for the small burg of Waverly, Virginia, where Ira accepted a job as school principal. It was there that Shirley MacLaine would be born and Warren Beatty conceived. Kathleen Beatty later ascribed their move to Waverly as a decision made necessary by the Depression, but in truth, Ira Beatty had lost his confidence, resigning himself to a life of caution. The little episode at Johns Hopkins probably blunted his opportunities to achieve what he was otherwise capable of, analyzed a friend of 30 years. The Beattys may have considered their stature diminished by Ira's position as principal of the Waverly School and Kathleen's role as his muse, but they left an indelible imprint on the community and on the students they taught, who exalted them. Hannah Allen, the teacher most admired in Waverly, considered Ira Beatty an excellent educator, and indeed, he blossomed in the esteem of the community. Elizabeth West, who was a popular ingenue when Beatty became principal, found him very dapper, in a shirt and tie every day, with trousers fashionably creased. West's experience foreshadowed Ira Beatty as a father, when she, whom Beatty considered a talented pianist, paid more attention to her teenage boyfriends than to practicing before a concert. He let me know, in no uncertain terms, that he was very disappointed in me and thought I was wasting a gift, a talent, and he shamed me. West was shaken by Beatty's harsh response, but I must admit, I did go on and major in music in college. He apparently had more appreciation of what I was about than I did. Kathleen Beatty, though more reserved than her husband, was dynamic in her influence at Waverly. She made an enormous impression on my young mind, said Elizabeth West. West gaped as Kathleen swept into the school auditorium on cold days, her tall, lithe frame elegantly wrapped in a long raccoon coat. Her enunciation, her whole manner was grace. I, even at that age, could appreciate anybody who could come in and pull talent out of a country high school. Warren Beatty's mother staged a full-scale musical at Waverly School. One former student was moved to tears by Tat's staging of the song Blue Moon, performed by a young girl alone on the stage, beside a blue velvet curtain, in a dress that was a contrasting, exquisite shade of blue. The Beatty's second autumn in Waverly, Kathleen became pregnant soon after her 30th birthday. Shirley MacLaine said later that her father had an eighth sense about women and knew when Tat had conceived before she did, demonstrating a mystic sensitivity to women's cycles that Warren Beatty reportedly inherited and put to different use. In February of 1934, when Tat was 7 months pregnant, Ira Beatty focused on a new, smaller career dream. He wrote to the registrar at Johns Hopkins, stating that he hoped to get his name on the approved list of school superintendents in Virginia. The registrar agreed not to reveal.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.